pase. Pierna derecha, directo al arco. ¡Golazo!
The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Mullins and Kevin Larame, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night. Welcome to Soccer Today for Wednesday, March 23rd, 2022. I'm Kev Larame, joined by Duane Rollins. Duane, how have you been?
I've been busy. I started a new job, as people that follow me on social media know, and it won't interfere very often in this, but you know how onboarding works. That word that when I first started work, Kevin, I didn't even know onboarding wasn't a word that anyone used.
Isn't it when you go into a plane? No, someone you're onboarding a plane. No, okay,
so it's when you read, like, watch YouTube videos and check. Yes, I understand what Wemyss is. Yes,
yes, I accept the accountability of what if I do something wrong, then I will get fired. Or
yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Oh, you know what time it is, Duane? It is World Cup qualifying time. Literally, it's time to qualify for the World Cup.
It is. I did want to quickly, if you could throw the TFC, we're going to talk TFC just for a second, because I had 2 days off and I do need to, like, celebrate the fact that the young TFC team that I am very much in love with, I love watching this team more than even the championship teams in some way, because they're so raw.
Yeah, you're also a nerd, no offense, but yes, I agree.
Yeah, Jaden Nelson, for instance, in this game, he had all these crazy runs up the wing, and then he just, like, the first goal, he was just kind of like, what's happening here as the guy runs past him? Like, I mean, they're very interesting to watch. But no, congratulations to Bob Bradley and TFC for getting that first win. I thought it was well-deserved on the overall play of the day. Mm-hmm. Obviously, still a lot of work to do. This team is not close to a playoff team yet. We'll see what happens when Insignia comes in, but after what had been 9 games in MLS play dating back to October 2nd last year, to finally get a win at home for the first time in a long time, there wasn't a huge crowd there, 20,000 or so, which in that stadium seems pretty empty, especially when there will be 30,000 in there on Sunday. 30,000 people at -8 wind chill.
Yeah, it's getting a bit colder, I guess. If we can look again at the stats at Toronto, 50-50 possession, a high number of passes that's growing. There's going to be growing pains, of course, with this young roster, with Bob Bradley. But it's the first win by a Canadian team in MLS, and we've talked about this Monday when we reviewed the entire Major League Soccer slate of games from week 4, and you can go back to the archive if you haven't seen that show. Duane, now let's move and focus for the rest of the week, for the next 7 days. It is a time that has been really good for us, and yes, let's watch it. Duane's scarf. Look at that. Look at the Voyager's scarf here. Because it is Canadian, of course, men's national team time, U.S. men's national team time, and it is World Cup qualifying time in Concacaf, where a champion will be crowned, I guess, by next Wednesday. Here's the schedule of the Canadian men's national team in this window, Duane. March 24th, which is tomorrow night at 10:05 p.m. Eastern, in Costa Rica, in San Jose, Costa Rica, Canada will play. And we'll talk about the scenarios later on the show, in the possibilities of qualifying outright for Qatar on Thursday. March 27th, which is Sunday, at home at BMO Field versus Jamaica at 4:05 p.m. Eastern in the afternoon. That's a good, good call, because it's going to be cold, like Duane mentioned, -8, even though it's late March. And on March 30th in Panama, it will not be -8, that's for sure. It will not be on next Wednesday's big schedule in CONCACAF, where all 4 games will take place at the exact same time, being the last game of the window. Let's look at the entirety of the schedule in CONCACAF, Duane, because it's not just about Canada. There's other games that are going to be important, starting with Panama, Honduras. Yes, El Salvador and Jamaica start just before that at 7:05, but Panama, Honduras at 9:05 this Thursday is important, because without even playing, Canada could qualify with the result of that game. Of course, a couple of other scenarios: an outright win, Canada wins, they move to the coast to Qatar. A draw with a couple other favorable results, which means a win or a draw by the U.S. by Mexico versus the USA, and Panama draw or a loss versus Honduras, and Mexico win versus the USA, which is likely, then Canada is through. But Costa Rica, Canada, 10:05, Mexico, USA, it's going to be an interesting evening in CONCACAF.
Yeah, I wrote this down last night. I figured it out. Well, I just asked my Google Assistant. But it's been 13,359 days since Canada last qualified for a World Cup. So, yeah, it's going to be a special one if it happens tomorrow. And certainly the math does work out that it could. Look, I think for a lot of us, we've all had our own emotional journey through this, and some of us longer than others. When it comes to this particular campaign, I am dreaming out in my head what it's going to feel like when that moment happens, because there's no such thing as jinxes, guys. There's just not, like, the amount of things that would have to go wrong for Canada to not get a direct qualification to this round. And even if that were to happen, they would still have another chance against New Zealand, likely. It's pretty astronomical. If that happens, then yeah, God hates our team. But
if that happens, God hates Canada.
Yeah, pretty much. So yeah, I've been thinking about that, but it's, to me, the moment, I think I've said this before, but the moment to me was the second goal against the US. Other people might say it might have been Alfonso Davies' goal against Panama. There was always a moment we had it where we just stopped worrying about the past and started to believe the Honduras win at San Pedro Sula might be something for some people as well.
And to me,
tomorrow, get out there. Either, I know you mentioned the weather. I have several friends that are down there, so my Instagram is full of beach photos right now, and I'm a little jelly, but
you know,
nonetheless, it looks like they're having a grand old time down there. About 200 of them, I think, made their way down, so that's great for them. They have a little bar down there. They're going to fill that stadium up. They're going to make noise. You know they are, but there's lots of viewings across the country. There's three in the city I'm in alone, so check the Voyagers page for that. Get out and support it. Stay at home. Be a couch alter if you want to. There's that famous Twitter account. I'm sure that they'll be on their couch somewhere. But yeah, it's a day we've been waiting 13,359 days and counting for.
Of course, there's also a scenario where it doesn't happen this Thursday and it happens at home on Sunday or even next Wednesday. And you don't want to do that. Yeah, exactly, Duane. You don't want to do that. You don't want to keep this in limbo. You want to qualify as soon as you can. Let's have a look at the table, Duane. It is quite an impressive table still after all this time. Canada on top, 25 points after 11 games played, a plus 14 differential, best in Concacaf, only 5 goals allowed for a country that was touted as the worst defense in the top teams in Concacaf. They've answered present, have shown up and kept a couple of clean sheets, only allowed 5 goals in 11 games, and quite the performance by the Canadian defense, marshaled by 2 CF Montreal players, of course, of Kamal Miller and Alistair Johnston. Add in some Steven Vittoria love and you got yourself quite a good Canadian defensive back line. Duane, how quickly things change.
No, exactly. I would say that the most unsung hero of this entire campaign is either Steven Vittoria or Alistair Johnston to me, or Miller as well. But the way that they have come together quickly to be, and not just adequate, but an above average defensive pairing back there. Now, you know, we worry about the depth a little bit, and that's fair. We're always going to worry a little bit. We got Danielle in there too with his open ice hit down in the ice Tecas. So that was fun.
He's like, what? Oh, wait, sorry. I was in Edmonton. You know, I thought I was in
the Rogers. Exactly. So, you know, he played his role too, because I think that cup put Mexico a little bit on their heels after that. So,
well, you know what? Exactly. Did you see? Imagine you're a Mexican player, it's cold, and you see Danielle Henry heading towards you. Yeah, you're gonna
take back, and then you get him off quick before he comes out too many more.
Exactly, because it's gonna hurt. Because you're like, I'm gonna hit the deck, and that's not gonna be pleasant. That's gonna be painful.
Look, exactly. Look, I think that there's an element of the offense is a good defense going on here too. That teams like Mexico, for instance, can't press too hard because you've got so much speed on the wings for Canada coming at you from 10 different ways, that if you press up too hard, you're going to get burnt. The U.S. learned that the hard way with both of their goals, basically, which came off of turnovers and quick transitions. This is just a team that can beat in a lot of ways. You mentioned their record. They're undefeated in this final round. They're undefeated in World Cup qualifying. There's only a handful of teams in the entire world. Belgium. Yeah. I'm not sure. I'd have to go look at the European results to see who it is. Like, we're talking top 10 teams in the world that have done this as well. You know, there's an article in the Times in the UK this week about the great comeback of Canada, calling it one of the best stories in all of world football. Like, we're living on the top of the mountain now.
Of course. It's also
a long time to climb there.
Of course, we have to also hold the horses. Like, it's a great story. It's a great comeback story. And the narrative is really easy also to be like, yay, Canada, the country of ice, the country that lives under a mile of ice, 25% of, you know, it's not true. You know, so there's also, we have to, but yes, I absolutely agree that that story is amazing. And for sports editors around the world, it's also a very easy narrative of saying, hey, Canada, the North Pole is good at soccer.
Oh yeah, we're going to be the Iceland of the World Cup if it goes, especially the juxtaposition between having Canada and Qatar in a desert, like the,
come on,
the Arctic and the desert, right?
Yeah, because you could be like, oh, the furthest point represented, and you like you take Fort McMurray instead of taking like Toronto, and then you can draw the distance. Like, yeah, that's Canada, all right?
Yeah, there's, I saw this map the other day that's like, it's show maps of North America, shows where the closest world capital is, and I think if you go to the very top part of our country, it's like Moscow. It's like, you know, it's a pretty big landmass.
Very interesting at this type of, in this, in this topic.
Yeah, enough said there, the better, but.
Yes, exactly. All right. In this, of course, we can go back to the standings here before we continue our conversation. We'll go down through the roster together because I do want to have your opinion on the Canadian roster on a few spots there. But let's look at the standings right now. We talked about Canada. The U.S. is second with 21 points. Mexico is third with 21. And Panama, 17. The big battle, Duane, of course, is between Panama and Costa Rica. The only spot that could really change here is the fourth, where Costa Rica could swipe in. I don't think the stars are going to align for El Salvador for them to win three games, to have Panama lose three games and Costa Rica lose three games. Because that's the only scenario that would see El Salvador make them through, so that's not happening. Panama, Costa Rica could upset and maybe get Panama's spot. Mexico and the U.S. could slip down and maybe even go to fourth, depending on Panama's results. But with recent struggles of the Panama national team, they started really hot and they struggled as of late. Costa Rica's been really hot. Maybe there's something happening there. What is your thought in the schedule around CONCACAF this weekend also?
Look, I watched Costa Rica pretty closely in the last window, and they're just not firing the way that they once did. I would be very surprised if Canada doesn't get a result down there tomorrow night. We'll see. We'll talk about that in more detail tomorrow. But for them to win out, which is kind of what they have to do to take over fourth, I think. I mean, yeah, there could be other back-end results, but they were very lucky to beat Panama in that last round. They were badly outplayed. They just got a couple lucky goals. I was very excited about it because I may have had a bet on it. So that worked out for me, but it was kind of one of those fortunate results. I would be surprised if they were able to win out. You know, El Salvador, quickly on them, they're not going to get fourth. Like, that's not going to happen, the stuff that has to, but they do deserve a round of applause. They have played very well to get as far as they have. That is a tiny, tiny, tiny nation. It is smaller than Mississauga, I believe, in population.
Yeah,
so, you know, for them to get this far along is pretty impressive on its own. But yeah, they're a little overmatched in this round. Look, it's going to be very interesting, final thought on this. Very interesting if there is not a draw in that U.S. game against Mexico. If one of those two teams beats the other and the full 3 points goes one way and not the other way, depending on the results, you could have some shaky nerves going into that second game.
Imagine if it's the States. Imagine how then the PTSD of the last cycle comes into play. And then we could be like, well, this is how we've been feeling since 1986. Welcome to our world. And the pain is real.
Exactly. Well, yeah. I think Canada, U.S., Mexico are pretty much going to go through. We've been saying that for two windows now. Outsiders have been saying it even more firmer than us. I think that the Americans have, as you say, the PTSD of that fluky last day, you know, in Trinidad and Tobago last year or last cycle. I've said this before on the show. I'll say it again here. There was a lot of dumb luck that happened that night. Like the one goal didn't go in, for God's sakes. Like they got, if VAR's in place, they're probably in the World Cup.
How far was the goal too? Like the goal that, like the third goal for Trinidad and Tobago was what, from 35 yards away?
Yeah.
And it was windy. It was like the amount of things that needed to go wrong. But you mentioned the States, and we can talk about this after the break. The States do not have their number one lineup. Like their very popular goalkeeper right now that's going to go play for Arsenal is ill at this moment. It's been a while now, he hasn't played. You also have Weston McKennie, who's not available, who has been maybe their best player over the last couple of windows and the most influential players in the results of the national team. And even for Juve, which doesn't mean a whole lot because Juve's been struggling. The old lady is struggling in Serie A, but he won't be available. So we'll talk about that after the break, Duane. But you're right, for Canada, it's when, and that when could be Thursday night.
Yeah, and I hope it is. I mean, look, as much as I would have liked to be in the stadium, and I actually contemplated pulling out the credit card and going to Costa Rica, nice little break from winter would have been good too. As I mentioned, those Insta pictures are pretty nice to look at, but ultimately I decided that I would rather be here, save my money for potentially a trip in November, and enjoy it with people that I've seen these games with a long time. So, you know, I'll be at the Paddock in Toronto is the viewing that I'm going to go to. If anyone wants to say hi, come to the Paddock. It's right at Queen and Bathurst. So yeah, behind the pizza, there's a pizza on the corner. It's just behind it. There you go.
I'll be.
Don't eat at the pizza though. Whatever you do, are they a sponsor? I don't know, no, but I here. Would not.
I will be right here in this studio because I watched it. Other games on the second screen at the same times, because that's what I do, of course, getting ready for next day's show, which will be ready for our next segment, because after the break, Don and I will break down the USA's roster. We'll look also at Canada's roster. We haven't got there too, so we'll break down Canada and the USA's roster. We'll also look at the schedule for the USA. Will the USA qualify? Those are great questions, and we'll see if we have the answer after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sports podcasting network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kevin Armit with Duane Rollins as we talk about World Cup qualifying time in CONCACAF. And Canada has announced its roster last Sunday, Duane. And let's look at some of the interesting choices that we saw John Herdman do. Of course, we know that Alphonso Davies is not available for this window. He just returned to training two weeks ago now at this point. So still not available. There's a couple of injuries, especially for Samuel Piette in the midfield and other players. But we're seeing young players like Ismaël Koné get their first selection, maybe even their first cap in this window. Ismaël Koné, 19 years old, CF Montreal midfielder, already a goal and two assists in Major League Soccer this season. In CONCACAF, a goal and an assist also. We're seeing a great blooming of Ismaël Koné, and that led to John Herdman already selecting him. And even mentioning, Duane, that he doesn't see his profile. He doesn't see the type of player that Koné is in other players. It's a very unique profile, according to John Herdman.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's a player that came maybe not out of nowhere if you're in Montreal, but for those of us in the rest of the country, it's a bit of a surprise. Anytime a young guy emerges from one of the academy systems, you are going to be a little bit taken by it because you're not necessarily living day in, day out on these guys. I was saying to you off air, I think he does have eligibility for Cote d'Ivoire as well. So perhaps this is a preemptive strike.
Yeah. Hopefully. He was born in Cote d'Ivoire and grew up here in Canada, was developed by the NDG Soccer Association to begin his very young career. Then at the elite level, CS Saint-Laurent on the west end of Montreal. And of course, we're seeing a great and pretty impressive progression. He had some injuries over the last couple of years that delayed his arrival. He should have arrived with the first team last year to the level he's playing now. We're seeing a great performance by Ismaël Koné, and he got the selection with the national team. Let's continue to have a look at that roster. In net, Milan Boyan, Duane, and I was talking on the solo show yesterday how if Canada wins on Thursday night, Milan Boyan's going to play, and imagine Canada wins, okay? So that's already great. Then what do? Do you send Crépeau in net for Sunday? Or do you send Dane St. Clair in net Sunday? Dane St. Clair has performed amazingly against New York a couple of weeks ago in Major League Soccer when he was asked to play last minute. And to me, that shows the potential he has. And also, you want to have more than just... Like, it's great to have a hierarchy, and it's great to be out. If it's not Boyan, it's Crépeau. But you got to give other people some look too. This could have been James Pantemis if James Pantemis would have been playing. He's not, and John Herdman is steadfast in thinking and actually selecting players that are playing. If you're not playing for your club, you're not going to play. And Daniel Henry's happy about that because he was close to being an attached FC, and then he wouldn't have made the roster.
Yeah, and look, I mean, we've got to start thinking ahead to November, too, if we're being quite blunt here. They're going to play again in either October or November, regardless. They're going to play games before that for sure. But, I mean, worst case scenario, they're still playing a very important game in October, right? So you got to start thinking to that. You got to start making decisions about your fourth left back or your third keeper and things like that. And Dane St. Clair is an immense talent that it doesn't always put it all together. He's had some great streaks for Minnesota. He's lost his job for Minnesota. So you kind of have to maybe give him a look at some point. Now, in terms of if Canada qualifies on Thursday night and they're going into the game on Sunday, I kind of like to see Borjan on the capo stand personally with a beer in a hand, with holding up sweatpants and drinking with the fans. I think that would be fun. However, that's I doubt true. That's what they're going to do.
That could be. I also like their decisions to go young and with players that have shown what they can do in this process. Come on, Miller, Steven Vittoria, Alistair Johnson, of course, as a fullback, Christian Gutierrez, not necessarily having the best of time with Vancouver, but has played well for the national team. Up front, Jonathan David, Junior Horlat, Tejan Buchanan, very important pieces. We'll see how they include a Jonathan Rosario, who's playing a lot better than he was last year at the beginning of this process. Jonathan Rosario with the club, he's maybe TFC's best player this year so far, with Jesus Jimenez. So those two players, the double J's, I guess double J is the way to go for Toronto.
Yeah.
Mark Anthony K is also an important part of this game. But, you know, how do you think Atiba is going to feel when the third whistle blows on Thursday night?
I hope they carry him off the pitch. They might. I mean, they might. Look, he's going to feel great. And he is going to be, I've said this before, the narrative around Alphonso Davies is understood. Around Jonathan David, he'll probably have made a transfer by that point. He'll be well understood. But I think that a lot of the camera time, a lot of the special interest shows on TSN in the lead up to the World Cup will be about Atiba Hutchinson and how he's been criminally underappreciated for years, right? And they'll be talking about him, the king of Istanbul, all this sort of stuff, right? Like, it's going to be amazing. And I'm actually the amount
of footage with voiceovers of Matthew Schanetti that we're going to get on TSN over the next few months will be amazing.
Yes, exactly. You know, you can pitch what we're talking about here. Like, we know what is happening here. Look, it's fun times. It's great times. And the thing about Atiba, though, too, is he's still contributing. He scored the goal in El Salvador to put them on the brink, right? Like, this is a guy that has two big goals in qualifying. He scored a goal in the Honduras game as well to tie it up. So he's got two goals in the final round. That's just for a guy as old as he is. He will be something like the fifth oldest player to ever play in a World Cup if he makes that roster.
Well, one of the oldest, of course, is the Hungarian goalkeeper, Gabriel Gabal, a couple of years ago.
Yeah, but look, I have heard, I think I said this on the show before, that Atiba's contract ends with Besiktas at the end of this year in May, so that what they're pushing for is for him to have a short stint playing as an elder statesman for TFC. They're trying to convince TFC to do that. He's from, of course, this area. So for him to come in and just be playing until the end of the year is something that they do have to figure out.
I agree. But, you have to make sense, Duane. And, you need other players on the national team to be around you. So maybe you should come to Montreal because, he would be playing with Alistair Johnston and Kamal Miller and those two players and maybe Victor Wanyama. Can you imagine that midfield and that defense with Atiba Hutchinson, Victor Wanyama, like two versions of Gandalf that nobody will pass? Nobody shall pass. And,
go ahead. You can also play for Valor if you like.
Sure. I think he could probably choose, pick and choose at that point.
Yeah. So at any rate, but hopefully they can find him someplace to play. Because Besiktas, from their personal perspective, they want to keep him around. He'll probably go back to,
stay
there, but he can't there anyway. No, look, it's just briefly, the one other player I want to highlight. You did mention Osorio. He is playing brilliantly. He added probably 5-10 pounds of muscle in the offseason, too. You can really tell when you see him in person. He's very lean right now. That goal he scored on Saturday was outrageous. For him to be able to do that, to add that to his arsenal, would be absolutely incredible. And the great thing about a guy like that is he can play in the wing, he can play in the 10, he can play in 8. I think he could play fullback if they wanted him to. He can play all over the pitch, and you need a guy like that in a final World Cup roster too. Obviously he's a TFC legend, so that ties all the worlds in there. It's played a decade now here. Longest serving Toronto athlete for any professional sports team in Toronto right now. Jonathan Lazario.
Oh, really? That's an interesting aspect.
Yeah.
That's
Morgan Riley second by a couple months.
Okay, a couple months. Sure.
Hockey reference.
Always have to double check Morgan Riley because the spelling of Riley is not what you think. It's always a double check. Like, all right, yeah, it's true. He spells it differently. And so you don't want to mistake on air. That's very important. Let's talk about the United States before we say goodbye for today, Duane. Let's look. Tomorrow we'll preview, by the way, if you're just joining us, if you're new to our show, tomorrow will be our preview show where we'll look at a potential starting 11 for Canada. I will do some deep dive into the roster today and look how I would position them, and we'll discuss that tomorrow, and that's always fun. We'll look, of course, at the potential games and the history of the games between each other and what happened over the last few months tomorrow in the World Cup qualifying preview show. But when I look at the USA's roster in this window, there's a couple of big names missing because of injuries. We're talking about Weston McKennie. We're talking about also players that have performed well, like goalkeepers that are well touted and move into Europe. We're talking about, of course, Matt Turner, who's not available at this point. Zach Steffen's not fully in, well, he's fully fit, but he's not in game shape to the point that he could have been. We're going to see Sean Johnson. We're going to see Sean Johnson in World Cup qualifying. When I look at this setup, young players like George Bello making their debut with this team, Eric Palmer Brown, very young players. And then you have, of course, Kellen Acosta, who's not having a breakout time this year with Colorado. I'm not worried, but I'm also not convinced that this roster can get goals and can beat Mexico at home, because that's what they have on the schedule for tomorrow night.
The one thing that the U.S. has over Mexico is a psychological advantage, which seems weird to say for me as someone who's watched CONCACAF for a long time, but that's been turning for about 5-6 years now. The U.S. has won, I believe, the last three games that matter against that team. They have consistently good results. They won in World Cup qualifying, Dos mm-hmm. Zero,
exactly.
Famously. They won the Gold Cup final. They won the Nations League final. So those are the three big games that they've won in a row. So they do have that bit of an edge. Now, this is the Azteca. This is still Mexico. They are still immensely talented, although it is a bit of a down cycle, I think, for that team. I'm not sure exactly why. I might have to talk to a Mexican expert at some point to figure it out, because
you're right. It's also a down cycle, Duane, in the popularity of the national team in Mexico. It's a down cycle in the hostile environment. Going to the Azteca is not hostile anymore. It hasn't been for a bit, but now it's like confirmed. We've seen it in the Champions League, in the CCL. We've seen teams like Montreal get results over there. Well, lose 1-0, but lose 1-0 over there, it's not bad, right? And that's what we've seen lately.
Yeah, look, and I remember when Canada got the draw in the World Cup qualifying cycle. I had to check during the game. I literally checked my phone. Is this game at Azteca? Because it didn't seem it, right? Like, it didn't have that aura that it passed you. That's because it's at night. You don't have the smog. You don't have people that have been drinking all day. Like, it seems like a family affair out there. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, because we've seen tragic things that happened in Mexico. But
it's also because of that the enthusiasm for soccer is not at its pinnacle right now in Mexico. I think it's important to mention that the sports in vogue in Mexico right now are not necessarily soccer. It's not football. It's American football. It's baseball. Those are the up-and-coming sports. Esports to a point, but we're looking at a different type of generational love, and there has been some controversies with the recent violence that has dampened that enthusiasm, but it's not the same. It's not 2010. It's not 2014. This is not how Mexico is going to make it to the semifinal. This is, if Mexico make it to the World Cup, we just hope they don't get exposed.
Yeah, look, I see a lot of the passion I see with the Mexican national team, men's national team, we should mention, because their female national team is starting to really evolve into something that I think eventually might be a real player in this region. But the men's national team, I see the passion. Ultimately, a lot of it comes from Americans, that expat Mexicans that have moved to the United States. I think they hold it on as part of their culture, and that's understandable. And you know, beautiful in many ways. So I see a lot of that passion there, particularly that's why they play in Houston all the time. That's why they play in that. But that conversely, because they play in Houston to get the huge crowd and get the money, that means they're not playing in Monterrey. So they're not getting that same kind of crowd build up. We have this conversation in Canada all the time with like all the games are in Toronto or centrally in Canada
Montreal,
anyway.
Exactly. Because Montreal's complaining, Vancouver's complaining, the East Coast is complaining, of course.
Yeah, because it's a big country. Well, Mexico's a big country too. It's not as big as us, but it's still a big country.
Mexico's massive. It's not like one. It's different nations, right? Mexico is not homogenous in the way that we think about it too. And you're right. Having a game in Monterrey, and of course you wouldn't have games in part of the west of Mexico at this point. There's some parts of Mexico that might not be suitable to host games safely, just due to due to just what happens in the world. There's other parts that Guadalajara could have games, and you could have games in Mexico City more often, of course, by Azteca, the home of the Mexican national team. But this is not your big brother's Mexico. So does the U.S. qualify? All that to circle back to the USA.
Yeah, we're talking about the United States here, yeah.
Exactly. So this is circle back to the USA's roster and to the USA. Does they get the job done this window? And there's an article, and I haven't said it to you, so I don't want to put you on the spot, but there's a great article by Doug McIntyre on FoxSports.com. Fox Sports soccer writer, love his work for years and years, who talks about the big game for the USA is Sunday against Panama. If they win that one, they should be able to go through no problem, regardless of the potential loss in Mexico on Thursday. And then next Wednesday, they'll play Costa Rica. And you might think, oh, Costa Rica's beatable. Duane, out of the last 15 games played at home, they've won 10, they've drawn 4, and they lost only 1. Costa Rica. Even with this team, even not with their best group and core of players, they're in a downward spiral even. Not even a downward cycle, they're in a downward spiral. Still, Costa Rica is a tough team to beat at home, and they have the best home record in World Cup qualifying in Concacaf since 2 years ago. So, even though we think Costa Rica is hard to beat, you should not expect any result in Costa Rica, otherwise you might find yourself missing the World Cup. How important is that Panama game for the States?
As I mentioned earlier on the show, if there is a winner or a loser in that Mexico-USA game, there's going to be a lot of pressure on the next game that they play, because suddenly if you've lost two games in a row, then you are staring at fourth place, and that's going to be a disaster, particularly if you're in a hostile environment. And you're right about the Panama game. They don't look great at home, because I think they figured out that they have to play more defensively, even at home now, and I think that that's what they would do. They would look to frustrate the U.S., as we've mentioned many times before. They struggled to score at times. They struggled to score against Canada. They had a lot of the ball. They couldn't create a damn thing. Like that game, you know, what was it, 70% possession, but there was only one team on the pitch, and that was the team in black. They were wearing black that day, I believe, but at any rate.
Yeah, the team in red in spirit. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So look, if the U.S. gets to a final game, also the noise around that program, it's going to build and build and build and build, and you're going to have, you know, Taylor Twellman's out there, and Alexi Lawless is on there saying things and getting amplified and having USMNT Twitter, which is insane. No offense, guys, but you're cray cray. You're going to be out there making lots of noise.
At Duane, please. Don't add my account to the conversation. Direct your anger to this side of the screen.
That's 24th minute touch.
Thank you. Don't add soccer today either, because I'll get notifications and I don't like to turn my phone off.
Yeah, precisely. Anyway, but the pressure would be immense. If I'm predicting here, I'll damper that a little bit. The hate. I actually think the U.S. is going to get a result in this tackle. It might just be a draw, but I think that they will, because I actually am more worried about Mexico in this campaign.
That's true.
Which is why we went on the whole thing.
Can you imagine Mexico finishes fourth? Well, that is possible. Who knows?
They have before. They almost didn't qualify. The U.S. gave them a gift by scoring against Panama two cycles ago in stoppage time after they'd already qualified.
And then Mexico went on to the semifinals of the World Cup. The same World Cup they barely qualified to, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah,
quarterfinals, but anyway,
quarterfinals. But yeah, hey, Canada makes it to the quarterfinals, we'll be happy.
Yeah, no, it's a for sure. And no CONCACAF team has ever made it beyond the quarterfinals. So if you get that far, you're going to be okay. Yeah.
And yeah, become a thing of
on the men's side. Obviously, we're talking about the men's World Cup qualifying here. I don't want to have to caveat that every time I say it, but clearly that's what we're talking about.
Yes, because on the women's side, we have multiple World Cup winners coming from CONCACAF.
Yeah, well,
basically,
Olympic gold medalist,
of course, multiple times with the U.S. and Canada. But that does start us at the table for tomorrow's show, when we'll preview more in details and how we tactically think this is going to unfold. Duane and I will consult before the show, and we'll see John Herdman's evolution, of course, because we might see the return of the 3-4-3. Will it be the 4-2-3-1? Will it be a 3-5-1, I guess, 2-5? What formation will it be? That's a good question, and we'll break down that. What formation and what lineup I would choose to start the game, starting 11. We'll also look at the history between Canada and Costa Rica and the other matchups in CONCACAF World Cup qualifying, that and more on tomorrow's show. You can follow Duane on social media, on Twitter, at 24th Minute, myself, at Kev Laramie. You can subscribe to our YouTube page, of course, available at the URL youtube.com/sportspodcastingnetwork, and you can subscribe to our podcast feed to never miss a show. We'll be back tomorrow with a brand new edition of The World of Football with a Soccer Perspective. And until then, for Duane Rollins, I'm Kev Laramie. Have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.